The history of human conflict is littered with stories of bloody battles and awe-inspiring leaders, incredible victories and crushing defeats. But one element of warfare perhaps captures the popular imagination more than any other: the drama of siege warfare. This series tells some of the remarkable stories of military ingenuity, fortitude in adversity, and dogged determination of both the besieged and the besiegers throughout history. We begin in Europe, more than 50 years before the birth of Christ, with the siege that signaled the final defeat of the rebellious Gallic forces at the hands of the all-powerful Roman legions. Alesia, 52 BC. This is the statue at Elise Saint-Reine, erected by Napoleon III in 1864, which stands in honor of Vercingetorix, chieftain of the Arverni tribe, who somehow united the warring Gauls and led them in their great fight against their Roman enemy. The quiet provincial town of Alesia Saint-Reine is now a pleasant stop on the tourist trail at the heart of rural Burgundy. But in 52 BC, it was the site of one of the most extraordinary sieges in the history of warfare. It saw two remarkable military leaders go head to head in a monumental battle of wills. Lasting 4 months, it was a siege within a siege that absorbed hundreds of thousands of men. The two opposing commanders, Julius Caesar and the Celtic warrior Vercingetorix, and the battle that they fought, have all found a place in the cultural and military history of France. We are extremely fortunate that a powerful description of the siege was left to us in De Bellico Gallico, Julius Caesar's remarkable account of the Gallic Wars. It details the events of the siege and describes the complex siege works that the Romans constructed. However, Caesar's account should certainly be viewed with some caution. It was written for an audience and was as much political manifesto as battlefield diary. Indeed, Caesar's original title for the work is thought to have been Gaius Julius Caesar's notes on his achievements.
He writes his accounts of his campaigns and probably has them published back in Rome annually. And we know from other politicians that everybody was eagerly awaiting each year the publication of Caesar's latest account of what's been going on in Gaul. So he's very successful in presenting his campaigns with himself as the hero, himself as the principal character, and Caesar as the conqueror of Gaul.
While political spin may have been at work on some, the events that Caesar recounts have been borne out by excavations at the Alesia site, the first of which took place in 1861.
Oui, je crois que globalement on peut dire que oui, le récit de César est un récit circonstancié, beaucoup plus circonstancié que la plupart des récits de bataille antiques. Il reste bien entendu que nous avons à Alesia un cas très particulier, puisque nous pouvons confronter la réalité du terrain à celle du récit littéraire. Et c'est là un cas d'école tout à fait exemplaire. On s'aperçoit, bien sûr, que dans la réalité, dans le détail de la réalité, les travaux de César sont légèrement différents de ceux qu'il décrit, même si la description qu'il fait est une description réelle, parce qu'elle correspond en fait à une généralité du terrain et de la bataille.
Having already secured the governorship of Illyricum and Cisalpine Gaul, Gaius Julius Caesar had also become proconsul of Transalpine Gaul in 59 BC. With a view to increasing his political influence in Rome through the acquisition of further provinces, he had been campaigning in Gaul since 58 BC. Caesar was so confident with the way things had gone that by 55 BC, he proclaimed that the whole region was conquered. However, the Gauls remained defiant, and between 55 and 52 BC, there had been rumblings of revolt. In 52 BC, this dissent erupted into open rebellion in central Gaul. What was different about the 52 BC rebellion was that it saw the most coordinated and united force the region had offered in opposition to the might of Rome. The uniting of a usually disparate and factional group of Gallic tribes had formed a formidable alliance, one capable of mounting a concerted attack on their Roman enemy.
L'année 52 et le siège d'Alésia marquent pour César un tournant dans la guerre des Gaules, mais pas la fin. Un tournant en ce sens que c'est la première fois qu'il a trouvé face à lui une armée coalisée de la plupart des grands peuples gaulois. Il a encore à ce moment-là quelques alliés. Les Lingons en particulier, ou les Rèmes. Mais pour l'essentiel, tous les peuples de la Gaule centrale au moins sont contre lui. Et l'année 52 a vu pour la première fois une unité, même superficielle, de commandement de ces troupes gauloises.
The leader who had orchestrated this united force was Vercingetorix, chief of the Averni tribe.
The picture that comes across is of a man who's an astute politician. He had been in difficulties with his tribe. His father had tried to make himself king of the tribe and had been executed as a result. But Vercingetorix seized the opportunity when the revolt was starting and ensured that he took control of the revolt. He was clearly an able diplomat. Extraordinarily, he was able to get numerous Gallic tribes who previously had been unable to unite, and he got them to create a united front against the Romans.
Caesar was in Italy, furthering his political ambitions, when news of the rebellion reached him in early 52 BC. He responded quickly, so as to prevent the rebellion spreading, and to arrange for the protection of the province, his main base in southern Gaul. He crossed the Alps and the Cevennes mountains in very heavy snows and arrived in central France far earlier than expected. Caesar's return sent a loud and unmistakable message of intent, not only to the rebellious Gallic tribes, but also to his own troops. Having reunited his forces north of the Loire, Caesar recaptured Cenabum, modern-day Orléans, where the rebellion originated, then turned to fight his way south to the heart of the rebellious territory. As Caesar advanced, capturing town after town, Vercingetorix retreated in front of him, fighting what amounted to partisan warfare, and in an attempt to halt Caesar's unconquerable army, Vercingetorix ordered a scorched earth policy to prevent the Romans from seizing vital supplies from Gallic towns and any areas under cultivation.
Il me semble que dès le début de son insurrection, Vercingetorix a eu une stratégie d'ensemble cohérente. Bien sûr, ceci peut être discuté. Dans cette stratégie, il y a eu d'abord le regroupement d'une armée importante, le rassemblement de moyens militaires, de soldats, de blé, d'armes, et aussi la tactique de la terre brûlée qui visait à décourager les Romains et à les forcer à partir.
The scorched earth policy also meant that the Gauls could avoid meeting the Romans in pitched battles. Their previous heavy defeats had taught the Gauls that the rebellion was more likely to succeed if they could attack Caesar's supply lines.
In the early stage of the campaign, during the winter months, when forage is actually very, very hard to come by, the scorched earth policy adopted by the Gauls and by Vercingetorix is extremely effective. It forces Caesar to run round trying to find corn, and according to Caesar, Vercingetorix is so effective at bending the Gauls to his will and getting them to burn their own communities that on one day the Bituriges, a powerful tribe in the central of Gaul, burnt down 20 of their townships.
However, Vercingetorix's policy ran into opposition when it came to destroying the town of Avaricum, modern-day Bourges, which was said to be almost the finest in Gaul. Vercingetorix relented, spared the town, and was forced to become its defender as Caesar's army advanced in search of fresh supplies. It was in March 52 BC that the Romans lay siege to Avaricum. The Gauls defended their town with desperate courage. Caesar, in his account of the Gallic War, writes of the bravery of his Gallic foe.
One Gaul stood in front of the gate, throwing tallow and pitch into the fire opposite one of our siege towers. He was pierced on the right side by an arrow from a catapult and fell dead. Another Gaul, standing nearby, stepped across the body and did the same job. When he too was killed in the same way, another man took his place, then a fourth. The post was not abandoned by the defenders until a fire had been put out, the enemy pushed back at every point, and the fighting brought to an end.
After 27 days, Caesar's siege towers breached the Gallic defences, and Avaricum was taken. The resupplied Roman army moved on to their next objective, Gergovia, Vercingetorix's capital. This time, however, there was to be no triumphal entry into the town, and the attempts to capture it would cost Caesar dear.
Gergovia had been something of a setback for Caesar. He'd started off his campaign to put down the revolt very successfully at Avaricum, capturing that with a sensational siege. And he was probably attempting to do the same at Gergovia. Caesar ordered his soldiers to capture a hill that was adjacent to the main hill fort. And he claims that was all he intended them to do, but that they were so enthusiastic about capturing the first hill that they went on to try to capture the whole hill fort. Perhaps inevitably, with the troops that they had, they were repulsed by the Gauls, and Caesar lost a lot of men, a lot of his officers.
Caesar's account seems to differ from what the actions of his men, because his men seem to be quite happy to attack the city, but Caesar says that they are exceeding their remit and their orders in doing so. And Caesar, I think, is trying to get out of a defeat. He's trying to minimise his role in this defeat by claiming that the troops have exceeded his orders and fought on unfavourable ground against superior numbers. And so it's a get-out clause, essentially, that his account seems to sort of rub away at the reality of the events.
Forced to retreat from Gergovia, Caesar marched to join the army of his comrade Labienus, who was fresh from his capture of Lutetia, modern-day Paris. This new combined force now began to march south towards the province, modern-day Provence, during the summer of 52 BC. Vercingetorix, with an army of some 80,000 infantry and 15,000 cavalry, now attempted to intercept and destroy Caesar in central Gaul. However, after an indecisive skirmish near the River Saône, Vercingetorix, in a move more consistent with his scorched earth policy, withdrew his forces into the hilltop fortress town of Alesia, believing that Caesar's pursuing troops would eventually run out of supplies. It was here that the siege, one of the most crucial of the Roman period, and the action that broke the back of the Gallic insurrection, was to be played out. The stronghold of Alesia lay on an oval-shaped elevated plateau that rose some 150 meters above the surrounding valleys. It was just over 2 kilometers from east to west and 800 meters in width. It was situated at the confluence of two small streams to its north and south, the Ouse and the Ouse-Rhin. To the west was a great plain, now called Plain des Lumes, which was bisected by the River Brenne. The position was overlooked on the northern, southern, and eastern sides by a line of hills, which was about 1,600 meters from the plateau itself. It was here that Vercingetorix chose to establish what amounted to a last line of defense and awaited the arrival of a relieving army.
The city of Alesia was very well provisioned. It had enough corn for 30 days to feed Vercingetorix's army. It was also well watered. There were two rivers that ran either side of the citadel. And so by accepting siege there, Vercingetorix could feed his men for a month, but it also fixed Caesar and stopped him from foraging and meant that Caesar was going to consume the local environment's food very quickly with his very large army. And so it increased Caesar's supply problems, having to besiege Vercingetorix there. And while he was doing that, of course, the Gauls were gathering a relief force to come and hopefully, from Vercingetorix's perspective, hammer Caesar while he was still trying to find food.
Vercingetorix, seeing that the easternmost position of the plateau was weakest, built a 2-meter defensive wall that ran between the Ouse and the Ouse-Rhin. The Roman army approached Alesia from the direction of Dijon, and Caesar set about reconnoitering the position to assess his options. Caesar decided that an assault on the position was out of the question. And as Vercingetorix had predicted, his Roman opponent decided to besiege the town.
Toute la stratégie a donc consisté à enfermer Vercingetorix dans l'oppidum qu'il souhaitait défendre, d'une part en installant des camps romains sur les hauteurs alentour, tout autour d'Alesia. Ces hauteurs sont situées à la même altitude que l'oppidum lui-même. Et donc on a barré toutes les vallées et tous les espaces entre ces hauteurs. Ça a été le premier épisode du siège.
Taking position on the northern, southern and eastern hills, the Romans began to construct lines of circumvallation that were designed to surround Vercingetorix. Caesar writes,
I encourage my men to set about the strenuous task of constructing siege works round the place. The siege works we were beginning to build formed a circuit of 11 miles. Camps were to be constructed at strategic points, along with 23 redoubts. Pickets were stationed in these at night to guard against any breakout from the town. At night, they were occupied by strong garrisons with sentries placed on watch.
The siege lines that Caesar built, the physical defences, took advantage of the topography of the ground. Alesia itself, the hill fort itself, was situated on a diamond-shaped plateau, protected on two sides by rivers. He made use of the contours of the terrain and to ensure that the line of siege works completely encircled Alesia, but without putting any of his defences under particular danger.
Caesar's men began by digging a deep ditch on the plain to hamper attacks from Vercingetorix's cavalry. Two more trenches were dug in front of a 4-meter-high earth rampart. On top of the rampart was a wooden palisade, and along the rampart, towers were placed every 25 meters. In addition to that, there were 7 camps and 23 redoubts that were all garrisoned to provide bases for the various legions. In front of the trenches, Caesar had his men build lines of booby traps. First, the Gauls were to come up against the sharpened stakes fastened into the ground, which Caesar's soldiers called tombstones. Behind these were what they called lilies, pits with sharpened stakes placed in them, and then covered in brushwood and leaves, a deadly trap for any attacker. The whole system of defense was designed to slow down the Gallic warriors, making them choice targets for the Roman soldiers on the ramparts. These elaborate defenses afforded Caesar's men great mobility, which made communicating with the different camps far easier than if they had been in open ground. However, Caesar's siege works differed from previous sieges in one crucial respect, which meant that this was not going to be a repeat of Avaricum.
La situation tactique et stratégique d'Avaricum et d'Alésia est complètement différente. Parce qu'à Avaricum, ce que César a tenté, c'est un assaut, ce qu'il ne pouvait pas tenter à Alésia. À Alésia, il était obligé, compte tenu de la nature du terrain, de faire un siège, c'est-à-dire d'entreprendre quelque chose qui durait.
The way that Caesar besieged Alesia was unusual, not just for Caesar's sieges, but for Roman siege warfare more generally. Alesia was a passive siege. Caesar's aim was simply to blockade Alesia and force the defenders into starvation. He was not going to attempt to take the hill fort by assault. That's unusual. The majority of Roman sieges combined both holding up the defenders through circumvallation combined with attempts at assault.
From within the walls of the fortress, Vercingetorix watched as work on the lines began, and he decided once more to try and seize the initiative by sending out his cavalry, who advanced onto the western plain outside Alesia to make a lightning attack. The fighting was savage and bloody, but the Gauls were eventually beaten back. Most fled towards the town, pursued by the Roman forces, and Vercingetorix was forced to order the closing of the gates in the town wall. As they slammed shut, those Gauls left outside were abandoned to their fate. It was now that Vercingetorix decided to send away his entire cavalry, with orders to recruit warriors from all of the rebellious Gallic tribes, and to march them to the aid of his besieged army. An army of 80,000 that had supplies for only 30 days.
Caesar had got some way with his line of circumvallation. Vercingetorix sent away his cavalry. He really had no choice in doing this because he couldn't afford to feed them. Horses eat an enormous amount of supplies, and he needed those supplies for his soldiers, his infantry. Once the circumvallation was complete, there probably wouldn't have been a great deal of room for manoeuvre for cavalry in the enclosed spaces. So they were probably much better off being sent out to gather the relieving army, to join up with the relieving army, and to harry any foraging parties.
Caesar soon became aware of the Gallic plan and was suddenly forced to contemplate the prospect of a combined attack by two armies. His response during the late summer of 52 BC was to order the construction of some of the most extensive and extraordinary siege works in the history of warfare.
The circumvallation was the first line of defences that Caesar built. Now, they were designed to encircle Alesia and keep Vercingetorix and the Gallic army in Alesia penned in. He then decided to build a line of contravallation. That was an identical set of defences, but this time facing outwards into the general countryside. That was to protect the Roman army against the expected Gallic relieving army, so that when the Gallic relieving army arrived, we'd kind of have a sandwich of sieges with the Gauls being besieged in Alesia, and then Caesar's army both besieging and being besieged within their own fortifications.
This second defensive line was over 20 kilometers in circumference and may have taken a month to construct. Not only was the building of a second line of defenses a major undertaking, but it must have struck a huge psychological blow to the Gallic force shut up inside the hills of the town.
The whole complex of siege works that Caesar has put round Alesia have a primary function of intimidation. They intimidate both the relieving force and also the besieged and dissuade them from attempting to attack this, and just shows off the sophistication of the Roman army at its peak.
As the weeks wore on, the position of the Gallic defenders within the town of Alesia grew more and more desperate. With food supplies running dangerously low, Vercingetorix called a council of his chieftains to consider their options. It was decided to lessen the number of hungry mouths at Alesia by offering the young and old to the Romans as slaves. However, when these non-combatants presented themselves at the Roman lines, Caesar refused to accept them and they were driven back inside. Trapped between the opposing armies, they eventually starved to death. In early October, however, it appeared that salvation was finally at hand. One can only imagine the delight of the starving defenders of Alesia to see the arrival of an enormous Gallic army, an army thought to number over 250,000 warriors.
When the relief force arrived, I think that the second stage of Vercingetorix's strategy came into play, and that was to try to sandwich Caesar's besieging force between the large relieving army that had gathered and Vercingetorix's own force in Alesia.
With the arrival of the relief army, the battle that would either crush the Gallic rebellion or scatter the Roman legions was about to begin. Caesar's account tells us that the combined Gallic armies hugely outnumbered his own force. For despite sending away his cavalry, Vercingetorix still commanded 80,000 men. The relieving army totaled an incredible 250,000 troops, meaning that some 330,000 men were massed against Caesar's army of just 60,000. It was obvious that the leadership skills of the opposing commanders were going to be crucial to the outcome of the battle. These were two very different armies, equipped with different weapons, employing different strategies, and commanded by two very different leaders.
Caesar was always regarded as one of the great military commanders of the whole ancient world, and in many respects that must be true. He was extraordinarily successful. He was a bold commander. He was a commander who was willing to take risks, sometimes considerable risks. He himself was a sound tactician. He knew what his aims were in both the overall campaign and in individual battles. And he had the field skills to bring success on most occasions.
La personnalité de César a été très discutée et je pense sera discutée encore très longtemps. Je ne veux pas entrer dans le détail des appréciations politiques parce que ça implique beaucoup d'engagement personnel. Ce qui est sûr, c'est que César, du point de vue militaire, était sans doute un des plus grands tacticiens et un des plus grands stratèges que l'Antiquité ait connu. Il entre dans la catégorie de personnages comme Alexandre le Grand.
Rather less is known about Vercingetorix, and what information there is comes from Caesar himself.
Caesar recognizes that Vercingetorix has very good military judgment, has sound sense. Vercingetorix is able to adopt a number of Roman techniques in warfare. He's able to make his Gallic forces encamp for the first time, it says Caesar, that the Gauls actually encamped in a semi-Roman fashion. He also adopts logistic warfare, which is what Caesar had been very effectively using, particularly in the early part of his conquests. Now it's turned against him by Vercingetorix and his men.
Vercingetorix had been very successful in his uniting of the tribes and averting internal power struggles. His coalition of warrior tribes was certainly very different from the organized professional legions under Caesar's command. Vercingetorix raised an army from all of the different tribes in Gaul, and each of these tribes was ordered to provide a set number of soldiers. Some of those would be hardened warriors, aristocrats for whom fighting was a way of life. They were experienced warriors who had probably fought against the Romans before. However, many of the soldiers were also peasants, who were not professional soldiers, but who were swept up in this revolt to provide manpower for the army. While a warrior tradition existed amongst the tribes, this culture was based on very different principles from the Roman army.
The Gauls, in terms of the way that they fought, were individualists. They were very, very concerned and almost obsessed with prestige and with prowess and demonstrating prowess, not to the enemy so much as to their peers. And so they're inclined to acts of bravado and individual glory and heroism on the battlefield. They're very much a sort of a heroic culture. And therefore, when it came to fighting, they were very, very individualistic and very, very gung-ho in a way. The various tribal leaders are competing against each other for the place of honour on the battlefield and for, you know, any slight of honour that they will contest. And it makes it very difficult to control an army like this, and Vercingetorix does very well.
Caesar's army, however, was a professional standing army whose trade was warfare, recruited and administered by Rome. Roman soldiers served for long periods within the highly structured military order. The majority of the troops were legionaries recruited from the Roman population, and the remainder were non-Romans who had signed treaties or agreements with Rome and fought alongside the Roman legions as scouts, skirmishers with slingshots, and bowmen. These units retained their own fighting techniques and leaders, and often proved very effective. The two opposing sides were also separated by their weaponry.
La guerre des Gaules est un conflit entre les Gaulois et les Romains. Chaque peuple avait ses traditions militaires. En fait, il y avait un très très grand écart entre les uns et les autres. Les Gaulois avaient un armement inférieur à celui des Romains en qualité, en quantité. Ils n'avaient pas de tactique, ils se lançaient à l'assaut très courageusement, mais ça ne suffisait pas contre les légions.
Many of the wealthy Gauls, many of the Gallic warriors, were probably equipped in a way quite similar to ordinary Roman legionaries, with a shirt of mail armor, a helmet, probably very similar in design to the Roman helmets, again a large shield, and a long slashing sword which suited the individual style of the Gallic warrior. That's the warrior, he's very well equipped, but the majority of Gallic peasants would probably have turned up with perhaps a spear and a shield. They wouldn't have had body armor, they probably wouldn't have had helmets.
Roman legionaries were very well equipped. Most of them would have had a mail shirt made of iron rings, which provided a very good defense, particularly against the large slashing swords that the Gauls used. They wore a bronze or iron helmet with additional neck and cheek guards to protect the head, and carried a large scutum or shield, a gladius, the short sword, a pugio, a small dagger, and pilum, the javelin. Many of these weapons were found during the various archaeological digs that have taken place at the Alesia site.
Alors, on a trouvé beaucoup d'armes à Alesia, et c'est même la plus grosse collection d'armes de cette époque que l'on possède aujourd'hui au monde. Ces armes ont été trouvées en trois temps. Premier temps, ce sont les fouilles du Second Empire, c'est-à-dire 1861-1865. On a collecté à ce moment-là dans les fossés, parce qu'on les a ouverts sur de grandes longueurs, des armes en assez grand nombre. Donc des épées celtiques, des boucliers celtiques, mais aussi germaniques, des casques celtiques, beaucoup d'armes de jet romaines, c'est-à-dire des pointes de pilum, des pointes de flèches celtiques et romaines, des traits de catapultes romains, des balles de fronde romaines, etc., etc. Donc beaucoup, beaucoup de matériel.
So a lot of amazing stuff was found on the side of the battle, amongst some this helmet, for instance, which is a Gallic helmet from a horseman, and you can see here a shot, that is an old one. So we have also a lot of swords. This one is Gallic, and it was carried by the people on horses, you know, during the final battle.
The huge relief force made up of warriors from 43 tribes encamped on a hill a mile outside the Roman outer lines. Perhaps the greatest strength of this force was its cavalry. These formidable horsemen fought with large spears and used long swords against the foot soldiers. The first large battle involving the relieving army took place on the plain to the west of Alesia. It was a brutal and bloody affair, and typified the savagery of battle in the ancient world. As the ferocious fighting took its toll, things began to look bleak for the Roman army. But Caesar's loyal German cavalry gathered itself for a desperate final rally, and somehow fought off the larger Gallic force, driving them back to their own lines. Seeing the carnage before them, and realizing that the relieving force was not about to carry the day, the defenders of Alesia retired into the town. Despite the terrible bloodshed and heavy losses, the first attempt to relieve Alesia had failed. But after a day's rest, the Gauls were ready to try again, only this time under the cloak of darkness.
It's clear that Caesar's superiority in cavalry, even though the Gauls have got much larger numbers of cavalry, clearly are very important to him in this battle. Caesar is able to rout the Gallic cavalry in the relieving force in a very large battle that is fought in the plain in front of the city. And this breaks the morale, to a certain extent, of the Gauls themselves. And they have to resort to a night attack in order to try and break through the defences.
Night engagements were comparatively rare in the battles of the ancient world. But now both the relieving army and Vercingetorix's force inside the town made a concerted and coordinated attack under the cover of darkness. Armed with grappling hooks and ladders, and fueled with fierce determination, the Gallic attackers simply hurled themselves at the fortifications. Those who managed to clear the obstacles were met with a barrage of Roman missiles. Javelins, slingshots, arrows and artillery rained down on the attacking Gauls. The result was confusion, and the attacks floundered. Many Gauls died in the deadly trenches and pits that protected Caesar's lines.
The relieving army actually was in danger of being outflanked and so had to withdraw entirely, and at that point Vercingetorix also withdrew. I think the Gauls had not carried out proper intelligence. I think they were attempting simply to swamp the Roman siege lines with numbers. They hadn't worked out where the vulnerable spots were in the Roman lines, and they weren't going to make that mistake again. They made sure next time that they'd done their intelligence work.
So the Gallic armies had been beaten twice and had sustained terrible losses during their attacks on Caesar's positions. The Roman siege works were proving to be virtually impregnable. The increasingly desperate Gauls now sent out scouts to assess the strength of Caesar's entire defences. They discovered that at one point, to the northwest of Alesia, close to the Ouse River, at an elevation known as Mount Ray, the Roman circumvallation was not quite complete. So a special force of 60,000 men, moving again under the cover of darkness, made their way around to the north of the Mount Ray Heights and lay in wait. The following day saw the most coordinated of all the Gallic attacks at Alesia. The 60,000 troops, commanded by Vercas of Alaunus, fell upon the Roman camp near Mount Ray, while the relieving Gallic army moved against the entrenchments and encampments on the western plain. And Vercingetorix's army at last attacked the fortifications beyond the 6-meter trench. Caesar now had to confront three large attacking forces at different points along his defences. The major attack on the camp near Mount Ray was helped by the fact that the Gauls were on higher ground and could fire down on the defenders. And by the afternoon, the sheer weight of numbers began to tell, and the camp was in danger of being overrun. Meanwhile, on the plain, wave after wave of Gallic troops attacked the siege works, scaling the defences by scrambling up huge mounds of earth that they had pushed against them. Once again, the Gauls came up against the Roman slingers and heavy siege spears, which took a terrible toll. However, the Gauls succeeded in pinning down the Romans, leaving Caesar with a stark and simple choice. He could retreat further behind his defences, or try to regain the initiative by breaking clear and attacking. Caesar chose to attack. He ordered Labienus, his senior lieutenant, to take a legion with him to relieve the camp at Mount Ray, while he himself set about repelling the attack on the plain. Caesar's renewed effort on the plain succeeded in beating back the Gallic attack. Gathering further reserves and his largely German cavalry force around him, he then hurried off to the encampment in the north. Caesar himself was prominent during the fighting and made sure he was highly visible by wearing his scarlet cloak. It was he who personally rallied his exhausted troops at critical and dangerous moments in the battle. But it was the sudden appearance of the Roman cavalry to the rear of the Gallic positions that provided the defining moment of the bitter struggle. With their sudden and unexpected arrival, the Gallic army was at once seized by panic, and within moments they were in retreat, a retreat that soon became a rout. There was, as so often in battles during ancient times, a terrible slaughter of the fleeing soldiers.
Caesar's view is that his arrival turns the tide of the battle. His infantry are able to repulse the Gauls. They start fleeing, and he then sends in his cavalry, and they simply cut down the fleeing Gauls. And not only is that the turn of the tide in terms of that particular attack, it's also the turn of the entire siege. That's the hinge point. And that's the final concerted attempt that the Gauls make to relieve Vercingetorix in Alesia.
En fait, la tactique des Gaulois, la pratique de la guerre des Gaulois, consiste justement à tenter de remporter la victoire et à partir. Ce n'est pas une fuite, c'est un départ. Une fois qu'ils se rendent compte qu'ils ne peuvent pas remporter la victoire. On en a plusieurs exemples dans la guerre des Gaules. Et quand ils voient qu'ils ne peuvent pas remporter la victoire, après cette troisième bataille, les Gaulois s'en vont. Ils abandonnent Vercingétorix et les siens dans leur citadelle.
Seeing that the relief force had been completely defeated, Vercingetorix had little choice but to recall his forces to the town. Leaving his fate to his fellow warriors, it was decided that he should surrender himself to the Romans. So it was that Vercingetorix, the man who had united the Gallic tribes against the mighty Roman war machine, who had tried all he knew to win victory but had failed, rode out of the fort and, laying down his sword, presented himself to Caesar.
By being in a static position, a besieged position, he's lost the initiative, he's put himself in a reactive position, and he's pinning his hopes on the actions of the relief army. If the relief army fails, then he fails, and of course when the relief army is defeated, he has no option but to surrender.
Vercingetorix was taken back to Rome by Caesar as a prize, a sad symbol of the Gallic defeat. Those that survived the slaughter were distributed to the soldiers of the Roman army as slaves, one prisoner to every Roman soldier. The most unified force to take part in the Gallic revolt was defeated. Caesar's victory at Alesia had crushed the most effective force to oppose Roman domination of the region. For Caesar, the victor, political glory beckoned. For Vercingetorix, the vanquished, there was only 6 years of misery in a Roman prison before he was paraded as part of Caesar's triumph in 46 BC and then ritually strangled.
Pour expliquer la victoire romaine à Alesia, plusieurs facteurs pourraient intervenir, permettraient de donner une explication. Je ferai parler Caton l'Ancien, ce personnage très austère, qui disait qu'on remportait une victoire avec la pioche et pas avec l'épée. Donc le siège est évidemment l'élément essentiel. Les travaux sont l'élément essentiel, mais il y a aussi la professionnalisation, le professionnalisme des soldats romains, leur armement, leur courage, leur volonté de vaincre, et en même temps un petit peu une certaine lassitude chez les Gaulois, une tradition guerrière qui les amenait à se rendre dès qu'ils voyaient qu'ils ne pourraient pas remporter la victoire.
In terms of the history of siege warfare, Alesia is important because of the scale of it. It's unusual for a siege to be conducted on such a huge scale with so many miles of siege works constructed. It's also important because it's unusual as a passive siege where blockade is the principal intent rather than assault. Perhaps most important because we have an eyewitness account, something that's quite rare from the ancient world. And okay, it's a very biased account, but it's the account of one of the leaders of one of the armies involved, and for that reason alone, Alesia is an important episode.
One thing, though, is certain. The Siege of Alesia has found a place at the heart of French culture.
En ce qui concerne l'histoire de France et les mythes qui sont nés autour de l'histoire de France, c'est un élément tout à fait considérable puisque pendant très longtemps, pendant toute la Troisième République et jusqu'à nos jours, on en a fait effectivement le début de notre histoire nationale.
Vercingetorix has become a French hero in the same way as Joan of Arc. The siege and his image have been used as a rallying cry for the nation.
Le siège a pris une très grande importance à l'époque de Napoléon III, un petit peu avant que les fouilles n'aient commencé, parce que Napoléon III accordait une grande importance à cette bataille. Pour des raisons qui lui sont propres, il espérait soulever le sentiment national à ce moment-là. Le site d'Alésia a pris une plus grande importance encore après la défaite que la France a subie en 1870 face aux Allemands.
Et dans ce contexte, Alésia a évidemment servi de symbole, symbole de la défaite, symbole de la résistance, symbole aussi de tout ce que la Gaule et la France, assimilée à la Gaule, allaient souffrir pendant des décennies. Donc, la figure de Vercingétorix a été très fortement sollicitée à ce moment-là. On voit déjà, avant la défaite de Sedan, mais encore plus après la défaite de Sedan, se multiplier les statues, se multiplier les œuvres d'art, se multiplier les représentations de la reddition de Vercingétorix, se multiplier aussi le mythe qui fait appel à la résistance.
Caesar's victory at Alesia is still one of the most remarkable feats in military history. A Roman army that had begun as a besieger had itself been besieged, and by an army outnumbering it by more than 3-1. Not only this, it had defeated a second force at least equal to itself. It had, by any standards, been a triumph. It was siege warfare, prosecuted with the highest degree of skill, discipline, and determination.